Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and the page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box. For the benefit of mobile phone viewers, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Now let's move on to the first news article.
This article is a response article for the sudden reaction of Pakistan after India has amended the provisions of Article 370 that gave temporary provisions and some special provisions to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. 2 days before, Pakistan has decided to downgrade the diplomatic relations with India by announcing few measures. They have decided to expel the Indian High Commissioner in Pakistan. That means they have asked Indian High Commissioner to leave the territory of Pakistan, maybe with the prescribed time limit. They have also decided not to send their High Commissioner to India. And they have also decided to suspend bilateral trade with India and also to review bilateral agreements with India. And also they have decided to observe the Independence Day of India as a black day. See, these measures are taken by the government of Pakistan to express its concerns regarding the recent developments with respect to the state of Jammu and Kashmir by the government of India. The author mentions that Pakistan has never recognized the legitimacy of elected governments in Jammu and Kashmir, and they have consistently described the elected ministers or the chief ministers of Jammu and Kashmir as mere puppets or powerless ministers. Now, why Pakistan is having this kind of a stand with respect to the territory of Jammu and Kashmir? This is because Pakistan claims that Jammu and Kashmir is a territory of Pakistan that is illegally occupied by Indian country. That is one of the reasons why they call Jammu and Kashmir as Indian occupied Kashmir. The author mentions that this is the first time Pakistan has articulated or made clear that Article 370 was aligned with the interests of people in Jammu and Kashmir. What was the point of view of Pakistan is that they will be able to sell some myth to the people in the Jammu and Kashmir, and this myth is nothing but that the Pakistan government on its own will be able to alter the existing state of affairs in Jammu and Kashmir. That is to alter the status quo in Jammu and Kashmir. This could mean that Pakistan government can someday annex the territory what they call as Indian occupied Kashmir, or this could mean Pakistan government can by international pressure keep various provisions with respect to Jammu and Kashmir intact. That is, say for example, the previous provisions in Article 370, or Pakistan might have told that one day we will occupy the territory of Jammu and Kashmir, or Pakistan may sell the myth that people in POK are much developed while comparing to people in Jammu and Kashmir. So the author calls these as myths. Now when we say permanent establishment of Pakistan government, we mean the military organizations of Pakistan or the other permanent decision making bodies of Pakistan government. Several times Pakistan has said that it can alter the state of affairs in Jammu and Kashmir on its own because they believe it is a part of their territory. And why author calls these as myths? Because the claims and promises made by the Pakistan government are not legitimate or not legal or not valid. And now that India has taken away the temporary and special provisions of Jammu and Kashmir as given under Article 370, Pakistan is under pressure to react. Now, this pressure, according to the author, has come from certain sections in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. Now, let us say some people are there in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir who are not yet totally interested to align the particular territory with Pakistan, but they have strong sentiments or cultural sentiments with the people in Jammu and Kashmir. These people in Jammu and Kashmir could be the relatives, the friends of the people in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. Now, if Pakistan is not making a statement against the Indian actions in Jammu and Kashmir, these sections in POK may alter their positive sentiments from Pakistani government towards Indian government. So, to restore or to maintain the trust of the people who are in the territory of Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, Pakistan is forced or under pressure to react to the Indian actions in Jammu and Kashmir. Now, certain sections, particularly in the POK, are not happy with the Pakistani government with respect to Chinese projects that are happening in the territory of POK. But somehow Pakistan government has to maintain the trust of these people if it has to keep the territory of POK and the trust of the POK intact. Now, the next point the author talks about why Pakistan cannot interfere in the recent developments with respect to Jammu and Kashmir. While some civil society in India and Indian citizens can have certain concerns with respect to the central government's decision, and these people from India, the civil society in India, can have certain concerns with respect to the restrictions on free movement of people in Jammu and Kashmir for the present situation, for the time being. These restrictions are called by the author as continuous lockdown. We also see there is suspension of communication channels in Jammu and Kashmir. But as citizens, we can have all these concerns, but does not give another country, Pakistan, the right to interfere in the matters of Jammu and Kashmir. This is because whatever carried out as an executive measure or in legislative measure with respect to J&K is an internal affair of India, and India has categorically said that we do not expect anyone to interfere with our internal affair. We ask them to reciprocate how India reacts by not interfering with any other country's internal affairs. The author also talks about what Pakistan may do in the days to come. It may take the issue of Jammu and Kashmir to the United Nations, and it may mobilize the Organization of Islamic Cooperation against India's decision, or it might send its diplomats or envoys to friendly countries, its friendly countries, so as to put some pressure on India. But the author says that India is well placed to handle all these challenges that can come through Pakistan. Particularly, India is well placed to deal these issues on the diplomatic front in the present scenario. Now, this is because in the last couple of decades, India's economic influence in the world has grown enormously. And one another thing is that the economic partnership that India has with major countries, it gives India an upper hand to deal with Pakistan's allegations with respect to J&K. And one factor that goes against Pakistan is that the Western world or the developed countries in the West are still having doubts about Pakistan's involvement in overt and covert support to the terrorism. When we say overt, it means open. Or when we say covert, it is secret. Overt means transparent. Covert means opaque. So Pakistan's open and secret support to terrorism. So these three points may work in favor of India in handling the predicted diplomatic pressure that Pakistan may try to impose on our country. The ultimate point of the author is that Pakistan must reconsider its decision to downgrade diplomatic ties with India. Whatever measures it has announced, it has to reconsider and has to change these decisions to restore diplomatic ties with India. This is because downgrading or avoiding diplomatic relations is never a good measure, particularly between two neighbors who have troubled relationship. One thing is that when there is diplomatic ties, when there are diplomats, they can reduce or alleviate the tensions between two countries, particularly during troubled times. See, if these diplomats are removed, when we say diplomats here, we can refer to the Indian officials working in Pakistan as an organ of India's External Affairs Ministry. It also includes Indian High Commissioner. See, if they are removed, the option of direct talks between countries will be ruled out. And there have to be certain kind of diplomatic relations because of welfare of citizens. Say, for example, imagine a case where some of the Indian fishermen unknowingly crossing the border in sea and unknowingly enter into the territory of Pakistan. Anyhow, to get them back, we need channels. We need diplomatic channels. So there will be several set of cooperations required for which diplomatic relations is necessary whenever two countries are neighbors. So then the author discusses about few incidents where the diplomats have been previously withdrawn, or countries have not sent their diplomats, or countries have asked the diplomats to leave from their territory. See, in 2001, India withdrew its High Commissioner to Pakistan after the parliament attack, terrorist attack on Indian parliament. But while India has asked its High Commissioner to Pakistan to come back to India, it did not send back the Pakistan High Commissioner working in our country. in 2001, reportedly two terrorist organizations that are based in Pakistan, particularly the Jaish-e-Mohammed and Laskar-e-Taiba, carried out terrorist attack on Indian parliament. The author also refers to a terror strike in 2002 carried out in Kaluchak. Now, this place is in Jammu. So, what happened in 2002, few militants reportedly from Laskar-e-Taiba has killed a lot of people who were traveling in a bus from Himachal Pradesh to Jammu and Kashmir. When the bus was traveling near Kaluchak in Jammu, they have attacked the bus, and it is said that they have killed alone more than 25 people in the particular terror attack. While India did not expel the Pakistan High Commissioner during the attack on Parliament, but in 2002, India asked the Pakistan High Commissioner to leave. That's what we refer to expelling. Now, the author mentions that diplomacy is a mechanism to ensure that communication channels between two countries is existing or is remaining open. Then the author talks about both countries using back channel diplomacy in recent years. The author is saying, though there can be back channel methods of communication, there should be presence of seasoned or experienced diplomats in both countries, for as it will benefit both the nations. Here, when we say back channel diplomacy, it means informal meetings or unofficial meetings involving high level authorities of two countries, or it could involve few members of civil society organizations, or it will involve some meeting for which there will not be any official press release of a particular meeting, or these meetings also can happen at the initiation of some third parties also. So, at the end of the day, the author says Pakistan must reconsider its decision to downgrade the diplomatic ties with India. See, these things will have serious implications with the carefully calibrated relationship, particularly with Kartarpur corridor or any other mechanism of growing relationship between India and Pakistan. See, Kartarpur corridor is a very important aspect of India-Pakistan relationship, particularly in this year, which has very profound implication on the sentiments of people following Sikh religion in India. The present downgrading of ties can also have implications on the developments with respect to Kartarpur corridor also. This can also affect various other facets of India-Pakistan relationship. So, these are some of the points to be noted with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now, let's see the next article. This news article talks about a report drafted by Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which is a United Nations body. See, the report is titled as Climate Change and Land, an IPCC Special Report on Climate Change, Desertification, Land Degradation, Sustainable Land Management, Food Security and Greenhouse Gas Fluxes in the Terrestrial Ecosystems or in Land Ecosystems. And this report has been prepared by more than 100 experts from around 52 countries, and it was released in a summary form. The land and water resources of the world are being exploited at unprecedented rates. This is the warning given by the report. And when this exploitation of land and water resources combines with climate change, now this is putting extreme pressure on the ability of humanity to feed itself. That is, when land resources and water resources are being exploited at unprecedented rates, and that if happens along with climate change, it seriously impacts the food security of human beings. Now, this is because climate change aggravates land degradation, particularly in certain places like low-lying coastal areas, river deltas, and some dry lands, and even in permafrost areas. When we say permafrost, it means any ground that remains completely froze. Or in other words, permafrost can be defined as a ground which includes, you know, soil or rock, even any other organic material that remains, either it remains at 0 degrees Celsius or below 0 degrees Celsius. And they are saying it should be there for at least 2 consecutive years so as to declare a particular region as a permafrost area. So, how climate change can aggravate or exacerbate land degradation? This is because climate change leads to increase in rainfall intensity. There could be increase in flooding, and there could be increase in the frequency and severity of drought in dry lands. There could be heat stress. there might be increase in dry spell or wind, or even there could be increase in sea level rise and wave action, and also permafrost thaw. This is nothing but melting of ice. So that is the process of frozen substance becoming liquid as a result of the rise in temperature, as a result of warming. And the report also says that because of global warming, there is a shift of climate zones in many regions around the world. And this includes the expansion of arid climate zone and contraction of polar climate zones. When we say shifting of climate zones, one example is expansion of arid climate zone or desert zones and contraction of polar climate zones. Because of the shift in the climate zones, as a consequence, many plant and animal species are experiencing changes in their natural habitat or in their ranges, and there is also drop in their number of species. Climate change through global warming, or by changing the precipitation patterns, or by leading to a greater frequency of extreme weather events, it has already affected the food security. And they say that in lower latitude regions, the yields of crops such as maize and wheat have declined. And this decline in the production of maize and wheat is linked to climate change. While there is decrease in production of these crops in lower latitude regions, in many higher latitude regions, the yield of crops such as the same maize and wheat and even sugar beets have increased over the recent decades. And the climate change has resulted in lower animal growth rate and also lower animal productivity, particularly in the pastoral systems in Africa. When we refer to pastoral systems or pastoral farming, these systems are farming is related to livestock rather than growing crops and other fodder. And grazing is required for these livestock farming. And there could be usage of the word grazing for the word pastoral farming also. Now, this climate change also has stimulated some response from the agricultural pests and diseases. In one set, we can see increase of infestations, and on another side, there is also decrease of infestations. Infestation is the technical term that we use whenever pests affect crops. And based on the indigenous and local knowledge, it is found that climate change is affecting food security also in dry lands. This is particularly in Africa and high mountain regions of Asia and South America. See, when because of climate change, there will be a varied precipitation or rainfall pattern in these regions that are already dry lands or already deserts. Now, if the precipitation even goes down, then it will have a serious impact on the available food for the people in this region. Because people in this region will not be able to handle the climate change, even though they have adapted to living in arid climate. Now, whether we have enough time to handle this problem or to address this threat as a result of climate change, the report says the window or the opportunity is closing rapidly. The report also states that half a billion people are living in places that experience desertification. That is, those places that are now turning into desert, and we have half a billion population of the world living in these places. And to give some representation or some rate to the land degradation, the report states that the soil is being lost between 10 to 100 times faster than it is formed by natural processes. So there is imbalance. Already we can say that around 10% of world's population remains undernourished. This number turns out to around 800 million people in the world. Now, this is the current scenario, and we are saying that the problem will increase as a result of, you know, degrading land and water resources, and in combination with climate change, it could lead to food shortages. The food shortages will have an effect to increase the cross-border migration. And the threat is that these problems could develop on several terrestrial environments or several continents at the same time or at once. So is there any way suggested in this report to address the threatening food crisis? Now, they are saying some actions. One is to build individual and institutional capacity, and then to accelerate the knowledge transfer, and then to enhance technology transfer. Now, for example, to accelerate knowledge transfer, now we can say that there were reports recently that once the knowledge about pollution and how the pollution occurs in New Delhi during the winter has been clearly explained to the farmers in Punjab and nearby states, we could see a drop in stubble burning practice, and we could also see commensurable reduction in pollution in the National Capital Territory. And we know that the process of stubble burning also degrades the land. How it degrades? It burns out certain nutrients available in the land already because of stubble burning. The report also talks about some actions that can effectively address the land degradation, and these are raising awareness, capacity building, and also educating about sustainable land management practices, and then extension of agriculture, and also extension of advisory services related to, say, land degradation, water resource maintenance, or also combating climate change. It says that a major re-evaluation of land use and agriculture is required. The report also deals with proposals to include increasing the land productivity, and it's also proposes to wasting less food, and also to persuade more people to shift their diets away from cattle and other types of meat. Now here we could see when more people are becoming non-vegetarian, or when more people are shifting their diets towards cattle and other types of meat, the industries will increase the number of cattle. Now, increasing the number of cattle in one way will have correlation with increasing grazing. Increased grazing is a stress on the available land resources, and it in some way it is related to land degradation. This is one way of seeing this thing. So these are some of the information with respect to the report. Now let's see some facts with respect to Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. See, it's a United Nations body, but it is not UN's principal organ. We have only 6 principal organs of United Nations. It's simply a body of United Nations that assesses the science that is related to climate change. The main purpose is assessment. It was created in 1988 by the World Meteorological Organization and the United Nations Environment Program. The objective is to provide scientific information at all levels to the governments, so that these governments can use these scientific information to develop national or subnational level policies related to climate. And whenever some important negotiations happen at the international level related to climate change, and these IPCC reports will be considered as key inputs to these negotiations. So it's an organization of governments that are either members of UN or members of WMO, that is World Meteorological Organization. It is said that at present it has around 195 members. Many people all around the world are contributing to the works of IPCC. Particularly for assessment, IPCC scientists actually volunteer to assess thousands of scientific research papers that are published every year. They provide a comprehensive summary of, you know, what is known about the drivers of climate change, the impacts of climate change, the future risks of climate change, and how to adapt and how to mitigate and how we can reduce the risks of climate change. It is said that IPCC does not conduct its own research. Rather, the scientists of IPCC, they assess thousands of scientific papers published every year, and they provide the comprehensive summary, as we saw already. To perform these tasks, the IPCC actually is organized in working groups and task force to carry out the responsibilities. So these are some of the information with respect to this news article. Now let's move on to next article. This news article is about the proposals to boost the status of protection for certain animal species and to delist a particular wild plant variety called as Indian rosewood. Before entering into the analysis of this news article, let's have an understanding about the mechanism of sites with respect to protection of species. CITES is not an organization, rather it is an international agreement. It's a convention on international trade in one particular aspect, that is the trade in endangered species of wild fauna and flora. Now the objective is to ensure that international trade in wild animals and plants should not threaten the survival of these organisms. The idea for having such an agreement or a convention to deal with international trade that goes against the survival of organisms actually started in 1960s. In 1963, a resolution was adopted at a meeting of members of IUCN. It is after this resolution, as a result of this resolution, the sides agreement was drafted, and after several deliberations over the text of the convention, the text was finally agreed among the parties to the deliberation, and finally it came into force in 1st July 1975. With respect to who can become a party to this agreement is that any country or even a regional economic integration organization can be a party to this agreement. One example for regional economic integration organism that is party to this agreement is European Union. European Union became party in 2015. About India's membership, India way back in 1976, it has become party to this agreement by ratification. This news article actually mentions about three appendices of sites that list wild animals and wild plants according to varying degree of protection. When we say appendix 1 deals with protecting the species that are threatened with extinction. Other than exceptional circumstances, trade in the specimens of these species that are threatened with extinction is not permitted. When we talk about exceptional circumstances, it may be for the purpose of research rather than any commercial interest. Now about appendix 2, these species are not necessarily threatened with extinction, but if trade is not controlled in these species, then it may lead to listing them in appendix 1, or it may lead to lesser survival rates of these species. Those species are protected under appendix 2. The appendix 3 contains the species that are protected in at least one country, and this country might have asked other countries or other parties to the CITES agreement for their assistance in controlling the trade in this particular species. So such species are called as or listed under appendix 3. In a way, this CITES agreement actually regulates illegal trade in the specimens listed, because anyone planning to import or export specimens of CITES species, they should first contact national CITES management authorities and they should get the necessary import permit or export permit for the particular species. This news article actually talks about 5 wild animal species and 1 wild plant variety. The article mentions that India is among some parties in proposing better protection standards for 5 wild animals that are Indian star tortoise, smooth-coated otter, small clawed otter, tokay gecko and wedge fish. The proposals are because of the high risks that are faced by these animals as a result of the international trade. Recently, in May, India, Bhutan, Bangladesh and Nepal, they have proposed to delist Indian rosewood from Appendix 2 of the CITES agreement. Now, the reasons are that the species are widely distributed, and in India, they are found abundantly in wild, and in some places, they are cultivated also. The species are known to have very fast growth rate, and they even have the capacity to become naturalized even outside their native range. That is, it can be invasive in some other parts. And if you look at the present situation, there is no need to protect further under Appendix 2, and there will not be any possible condition to move it from Appendix 2 to Appendix 1 for better protection. So these are some of the reasons why it no more need to be protected under Appendix 2 of CITES. One of the problem faced because of the regulation under Appendix 2 is that it affects the trade potential and trade benefits with respect to those who are working under handicraft sector. So if Indian rosewood is delisted from Appendix 2 of CITES, then it is projected that it will be beneficial for the handicraft artists. Now regarding Indian star tortoise, now the proposal is to move from Appendix 2 to Appendix 1 according to the news article. Now this is because of the growing threats of loss of habitat because of agriculture, and also there is illegal trade so as to use the tortoise as pet and also as a spiritual symbol. A similar kind of protection is also proposed for both the otter species, that is the small clawed otter and smooth coated otter. India is also part of the countries that are proposing to include the tokay gecko species and wedge fish species. The proposal is to include it in Appendix 2 of CITES. They are saying this tokay gecko is also called as gecko gecko. It is traded highly illegally as it is used in Chinese traditional medicine, and that is found to have impact on the survival of this particular species. So the proposal is to have trade, no problem, but the trade has to be a controlled trade so that there should not be any incompatible utilization of the particular species. The news article also talk about tarantulas so that to boost their protection. Now in India, we can find peacock tarantula in the Nallamala forest area. And IUCN says this particular species is critically endangered. This particular species comes under arachnid class, that is, it is kind of a spider that comes under arachnid class. The news article also talks about a non-governmental organization that is nothing but TRAFFIC. This organization is an NGO, global NGO, that is working on trade in wild animals and plants. Their purpose is for the conservation of biodiversity and for sustainable development. This organization started its work in India in 1991, operating as a division of Worldwide Fund for Nature. The purpose is to manage the trade in wild plants and animals at sustainable levels without damaging the ecological systems, and to make the trade in such a manner that it makes a significant contribution to human needs, and also to encourage the nations and the members for the conservation of wild species and their habitats. So these are the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let's see next news article. This news article is about the approval given by the Defense Acquisition Council for the procurement of two important things for the purpose of Indian Navy. Now one is a software defined radio, to be particular, which is called as SDR Tactical. And the another is the next generation maritime mobile coastal batteries. And it is said that this procurement is to give a boost to indigenization, because both these equipment are indigenously developed and they are of the latest generation with the latest technology and ideas. So they are saying it will give a boost to the Make in India initiatives of the government. This procurement was approved in one of the meeting of Defense Acquisition Council that was chaired by the Defense Minister. Now let's come to the software defined radio. See, it is a complex and a state of art communication system. When we say state of art, it means that the article or the equipment is very modern and is made using the most recent ideas and methods. We saw that it has been indigenously designed and developed. See, it is designed and developed by Defense Research and Development Organization in a consortium approach, that is DRDO in consortium with two more companies, with the association of two more companies. One is Bharat Electronics Limited and the other is the Weapons Electronic System Engineering Establishment. Here, Bharat Electronics Limited is a public sector undertaking coming under Ministry of Defense. Also, the Weapons Electronic System Engineering Establishment is also under the Ministry of Defense. Now, this SDR, it is said that it will enable information sharing, collaboration, and also situational awareness. It will happen through a high-speed data and secured voice communication along with anti-jamming capability. When we say jamming, it refers to the act of an enemy who tries to corrupt or alter the content of the original message or signal. So they will try to do this by transmitting radio frequency signals in the network, or they will try to block the message originally transmitted by our security personnel. Their purpose is to block the message so that it cannot reach the particular intended receiver. So therefore, the speciality with SDR is that it has the anti-jamming capability so as to safeguard from jamming. And this software-defined radio is expected to replace the existing hardware-based communication systems that are used by the Navy. Now, this is because they are saying the existing systems are serving only one purpose or single purpose-based communication systems. And this software-defined radio has multi-band capability, and also it will be multifunctional and can have multi-role or multi-mission radios. So therefore, it is expected that the existing single-purpose hardware-based communication system will be replaced by the software-defined radio. And this software-defined radio has form factors. When we say form factor, it is the overall design and functionality of a computer or a particular piece of electronic hardware. This design and functionality will be usually highlighted by a particular prominent feature. In this way, SDR also has form factors, and in that, the Defense Acquisition Council has acquired SDR Tactical. That is the one you can see in this picture. When we say prominent feature, we here actually mean the certain special features associated with the particular SDR. Here, SDR Tactical. It is said that it is a standard 19 inches rack mount radio with configurable 4 radio frequency or RF channels. These are some of the technical details. So these technical details will be part of the prominent feature we mentioned with respect to the design and functionality. Now let's come to the next equipment that has been approved for procurement by the Defense Acquisition Council. Now it is the next generation maritime mobile coastal batteries. Now these batteries will be fitted with BrahMos surface-to-surface supersonic cruise missiles. Now they are saying that these missiles will be deployed along the coast. These batteries have been developed and manufactured in our country by a joint venture company. To be particular, a Indo-Russia joint venture company. This company is the BrahMos Aerospace Private Limited. BrahMos Aerospace is a joint venture entity between DRDO of Indian government and the NPO Mashinostroyenia of Russia. Now the partnership was made to aim to design, develop, manufacture and to market BrahMos missiles, which is the world's only supersonic cruise missile system. See, cruise missile is an unmanned self-propelled guided vehicle. It moves in air actually through an aerodynamic lift for most of its flight path. Its primary mission will be to place an ordnance. When we say ordnance, it means a mounted gun or a special payload that will be hitting on a target. So the primary mission is to place the ordnance on a target. They fly in the atmosphere and they also use jet engine technology. The supersonic cruise missile type travels at a speed of around 2 to 3 Mach. That is, it travels approximately 1 kilometer in a second. And this BrahMos is said to be the only known versatile or flexible supersonic cruise missile system that is in service in the world. The first successful launch of BrahMos took place in 2001. This missile was test fired from the land-based launcher that is situated in Chandipur coast in Odisha. So these are some of the information with respect to this news article. Now let's move on to the analysis of next article. Now this question is with reference to Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. They have given 3 statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. They are asking to select the correct answer from the given quote. Now, during the analysis, we saw that this IPCC is a United Nations body. And the main purpose is it assesses the science related to climate change. So the first point is correct. Now the second statement, its objective is to provide governments with scientific information at all levels to develop policies at national and subnational level related to climate. So this statement is also correct. But the third statement, it conducts its own research. Now this is wrong. IPCC does not conduct its own research. The scientists that are working in IPCC, they assess various scientific and research papers that are published each year. So it is this part of assessment go into the various scientific papers and provide some kind of comprehensive summary with respect to climate change, the impact and also the future risks. So the third statement is wrong. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 1 and 2 only. Now this question is with reference to Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. They have given 3 statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. Now the first statement, only states can become a party to the convention. Here the meaning of the word state is a nation, a member country, right? So they are saying only countries can become a party to this convention. But we saw that country or a regional economic integration organization can also become a party. And we saw European Union is also party to this CITES convention. So the first statement is wrong. So we can eliminate option A. Now let's see the second statement. They are saying there is absolute ban on the trade of species listed in Appendix 1. Now this statement is also incorrect. Now this is because in exceptional circumstances, trade in these specimens are permitted. Now we know that Appendix 1 specimens cannot be traded for primarily commercial purposes. Here, exceptional circumstances could be for the purpose of research of a particular species. So the second statement is also wrong. The third statement is India is a party to this agreement. Now we saw that since 1976, India is also a party to this CITES convention. So we find that only the statement 3 is correct. So the correct answer is option B, 3 only. Now this question is with reference to BrahMos missile. Now they have given three statements and are asking which among the above statements are correct. The first statement, it is a hypersonic cruise missile. See, this statement is incorrect because we saw it is a supersonic cruise missile. So when we say cruise missile, it's an unmanned self-propelled guided vehicle. See, depending upon the speed of the missiles, missiles are classified into three types. One is subsonic cruise missile, then is supersonic, then hypersonic cruise missiles. If you take subsonic cruise missile, it flies at a speed that is less than the speed of sound. Now, speed of sound is 343 meter per second, and this 343 meter per second is called as 1 Mach. Okay, so the speed of subsonic cruise missile will be less than 1 Mach or less than 343 meter per second. Now, supersonic cruise missiles are those missiles that travel at a speed of around 2 to 3 Mach, that is approximately 1 kilometer in 1 second. If you take hypersonic cruise missiles, they travel at a speed of 5 Mach. So the BrahMos missile is a supersonic cruise missile. So the first statement is incorrect. Now the second statement, it operates on fire and forget principle. Now this is correct because missile guidance is not required after the launch of the missile, because it can hit the target even though the launcher is not in the line of sight of the target. Now the last statement, it says that it is uniquely configured for installing in ships, submarines, aircrafts and on ground vehicles. Now this statement is correct, and that is one of the special feature of BrahMos missile. While analyzing the news article, we saw that the one equipment that was for which the approval was granted by Defense Acquisition Council, that is the next generation maritime mobile coastal batteries. While analysis, we saw that these batteries will be fitted in surface to surface BrahMos supersonic cruise missiles. But overall, the missile can be configured for installing in ships, submarines, aircrafts and ground vehicles. So the correct answer for this question is option C, 2 and 3 only. Now this is a mains question under GS2. India's decision to amend Article 370 and to end the special status given to Jammu and Kashmir was heavily criticized by Pakistan. What could be its implications on the India-Pakistan bilateral relations? Now we saw Pakistan announcing some five measures that it has decided with respect to bilateral ties. One is to send back Indian High Commissioner, and another one is not to send its High Commissioner to India, and to suspend bilateral trade with India, and to review the bilateral agreements with India, and also to observe Indian Independence Day as Black Day. See, there are implications when there is, we saw even during analysis that when there are downgrading of diplomatic ties or relationship, so it can have an impact on various developments that are on the positive side because of the carefully negotiated diplomatic arrangements. One with respect to such a development is Kartarpur corridor. And we saw the second round of discussions on Kartarpur Sahib corridor happened in the month of July 2019, and both governments announced significant progress in terms of work of this corridor. And downgrading diplomatic relations will have severe implications on positive relationship with respect to these factors. Now, suspending bilateral trade as announced by Pakistan can have impact on people who are living near the line of control, particularly in Jammu and Kashmir. Now, this is because it is said that cross-border trade is carried out to the tune of around 600 crore value every year. So there will be loss of benefits because of cross-border trade. And this will also result into lesser people-to-people contact and people-to-people exchanges. Now, reviewing bilateral agreements is also a non-productive step, if at all that has to happen, as it will have implications on existing Indus Water Treaty or any other treaty with respect to border disputes. And the agenda of the Pakistan government to observe Indian Independence Day as Black Day will develop hatred to the country and hatred to the people of Pakistan among the Indian masses. So these are some of the implications that we can expect because of the announced measures by the Pakistan. So these are some of the points that you can take from today's analysis for the purpose of answer writing. in this question. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for daily updates and content on civil service exam preparation.